shares navigating through volatility after recession fears in the U.S. triggered a dramatic rout in global stocks earlier this month. All eyes are also on the Philippine Central Bank's upcoming meeting this August 15 after BSP Governor Ely Remolona hinted at possibly easing rates. But with inflation shooting past government's target in July, where should investors put their bets? Joining us now for our monthly market outlook, we have with us Charles Ang of COL Financial and Mike Enriquez of Sun Life Investment Management. So August is actually a very interesting month. Like, we started out with a very volatile performance globally. And, you know, here locally, we're going to have data releases, a lot of important data releases, such as, inflation and the GDP growth, plus, of course, the BSP meeting. What do you expect as far as the performance is concerned? Are we still going to see the market stay volatile? Let me begin with you, Mike, and then maybe you can add something to it, Charles.
Yeah, yes, April, I think the market will continue to be volatile, given that I think still a speculation on direction of short-term rates, or whether the Fed will really cut this September. And I think it's the magnitude that they're talking about, given that a lot of the sensitivities on economic data in the US, specifically the jobs. So those are the things that are really hounding markets. And to add fuel to the fire, the BOJ, I mean, previously Japanese markets were a bit quiet, and now the BOJ decided to follow suit or be ahead of the game and adjust their short-term rates, thereby dislodging markets. So I think it's quite interesting, because it's really outside of the radar of investors on what's happening in Japan. But now a lot of focus being put into what's happening in Japan, how it's affecting global markets and Asian markets in general.
Again, you, Charles, what's your opinion as far as volatility is concerned? Are we going to see more of it, going to the balance of August?
Yeah, I think that's very much a possibility, because I think what's apparent today is that there's really a lot of moving parts, not just in the Philippines with inflation, with the rate cuts, but also, as Mike mentioned, in Japan also. I think this is the biggest reason for the volatility that we saw the last couple of weeks. In fact, if I may mention it, it's really just the unwinding of the carry trade for the yen, because of what the BOJ did end of last month, right? When they increased rates, so a lot of the funds who are shorting yen or borrowing yen to buy global assets have been forced to unwind their positions. And this has caused extreme volatility in the US, in Japan, in the yen, right? And also, of course, the Philippines being a very small market, we're not immune to that. And in fact, we're also affected by that. So to answer your question, I think we should at least prepare for a lot more volatilities in the coming weeks.
You know, I guess the big question that everybody has in their minds is whether or not the BSP will cut in August, as they initially had mentioned in May, or will they wait for the Fed? Let me ask you first again, Mike, about your thoughts on this.
Well, April, I think our house view is that we believe that the BSP will proceed with cutting their policy rates by this month. I think there's a lot of reason for them to do so. I think for one, they have carefully measured potential impact on the currency. And especially now that the currency has stabilized or appreciated strongly. So I think that's a plus for them to really go ahead with that. And if you look at the GDP figure, right, it was really consumption that was still slow. It went up, but it was not really significant. So I think for the BSP to start helping grow the economy again, to really pump prime the economy, it's really government spending that really justified the 6.3% growth. And I think they've calculated it that in case they move ahead And if the Fed really proceeds with the September, then they still only have 1 month gap for any potential currency depreciation for on the peso. But again, the dollar is still being punished as well as we speak. So I think that's a plus for the BSP to add on to their assessment if for them to be more confident to cut by next week.
Charles, do you think that inflation is still a worry? For example, July inflation went up by 4.4%, if I'm not mistaken. So is that something that the BSP is worried about, which may push them to delay any rate hikes this August?
Well, to answer your first question, I agree with Mike that I think ultimately the BSP would still push through with the cut in August. Although, of course, it was in the news recently that the BSP seems like it's like hesitating a bit. I mean, like there's like a little reservation there after following, as you mentioned, the July inflation number. But on that end, I don't think it's going to be an issue going forward. I think it's mostly just timing, and also with the electricity prices. But I think it should normalize towards the fourth quarter, and together with the lower tariff for rice, which should come into effect by August, I think these factors would lead to more benign inflation for the rest of the year. So I don't think it's going to be an issue, at least for the rest of the year. And I think ultimately the BSP would consider this and push through with the rate cut in August. Of course, having said that, nothing's 100%, I guess. I'm less sure now than I was, 2 weeks ago. But yeah, that's where I'm betting.
Yeah, April, to add on to what Charles mentioned, if you look at the headline is higher than expected, but the core inflation is going down, in fact. So I think that's also a plus. So that's why I think that's a plus for the BSP.
So, Mike, you had mentioned about the peso being stronger. So what do you make of the strength of the peso? I mean, have we seen the worst? And can Filipinos expect the peso to be more stable or at least appreciate, especially for the importers?
Given that what's happening, well, if you look at the dynamics first and what's affecting the currency, it's really the stronger dollar. And right now, a lot of pressure for the Fed to really address the growing concern if they're gonna slip into recession. So really, it's more dovish right now on that. So it's really affecting the dollar. So that's why the peso immediately appreciated on that one. But if you look at the seasonality, well, this is also the season, August, September, that a lot of the companies are shoring up on their need for dollar for to prepare for the Christmas season. So maybe a little bit pressure on that one. But I think overall, what I can say is it's more stable right now. We don't see any immediate spike or a depreciation further of the peso from where it is right now. So I think that's a plus as well, especially if you correlate that with performance of the local equity market. We all know that if the peso starts appreciating, that is something always positive for the equity market here.
Maybe both of you, I'd like to ask, what are some factors going for the Philippines today that allowed us to escape a significant drawdown similar to what happened to other countries? I'll begin with you, Mike.
So I think for one, we never really participated in the US rally. I mean, our markets didn't move
Yeah, we
up.
didn't have those tech stocks,
We didn't move up. Unfortunately, we didn't have the right sectors where the flavor of the month, so to speak. But then again, the other factor would really be one, I think we're so under-owned already by foreign. And you know that what's driving the local market is really foreign money coming in. And if there's not much ownership, there's nothing to sell anymore. Second, I think there's a recognition by the local investors that at these levels in the market, it's really fundamentally cheap. I don't see any reason why you will continue to dump your shares.
I share the same sentiment. If you zoom out in the Philippines, we're in a very different part of the cycle. In the US, just as recently as a month ago, they're at record highs. Here, we've been sideways for the last 10 years. So, very different part of the cycle. Now, moving on to the earnings side, it depends on how you want to view it, half full, half empty. If you want to view it half empty, being slowing down, some other sectors like for example, take-up sales of, I believe, SM Prime slowed down in the second quarter. So there's some impact that we're feeling from the high inflation and the high interest rates that we've seen the last year or so. But at the same time, from a half-full perspective, right, we're now looking at these slowdown in light together also with the fact that our valuations are at record lows at the same time, right? So it's not as if our earnings are declining or crashing, right? It's just the growth is just slowing down. There's still growth by and large if you count as a whole, right? There's still growth, but it's slowing down. It's lower than what we used to see the last 5 years, but it's at least it's still growing.